here's a few reasons why people don't go to church.
I can't come to church until I get my life together.
Church is how I got my life together.
Church is filled with a bunch of hypocrites.
And there's always room for one more.
All they care about is your money.
They care about me, not about my money.
Is there some kind of dress code?
Yes, the code is wear some clothes.
Church, it just makes me nervous.
I was nervous at first, and then I felt right at home.
I'm not sure I believe everything that you believe.
But you can still belong.
Church is for wimpy, girly men.
You want to say that again?
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't want me.
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't be worried.
You can come to my church even if you were brought up
Catholic,
Baptist,
Methodist,
Jewish,
Mormon,
Lutheran,
Pentecostal,
Presbyterian,
Church of Christ,
Southern Baptist,
a little bit of everything and a whole lot of nothing.
See, it's not about a religion, it's about a relationship.
So please, come to my church.
Where nobody's perfect.
Where beginners are welcome.
Where socks are optional,
but grace is required.
Where forgiveness is offered.
Where hope is alive.
And where it's okay to not be okay. Really. And welcome to Rediscover Church! We just want to say welcome home. If this is your first time here, we are so excited that you chose to take time out of your Sunday morning to get up when you could have slept in, you could have gone out on the lake, but you chose to come to Rediscover Church and be with us, and we are honored. If this is your first time, Pastor Brad and I would like to invite you to what we do on Wednesday nights called the Newcomers Life Group. And what this is it's an opportunity for you to come and meet us. And mostly so that we can meet you. Because we want to know each and every one of you. And I want you to hear the really incredible story of why God brought this church to the middle of nowhere. Now don't be offended. Like, if you live here, just know you live in the middle of nowhere. We do.
Yeah,
we live right here, but God dropped us here for a really cool purpose, and we want to tell you all about it Wednesday night, 6:30.
Wednesday night, 6:30. Be here. It's going to be so much fun. We also have hot dogs, if you like hot dogs. How many hot dog people do we have in the room? Yes! I love hot dogs.
You can pass on the hot dogs and have the cookies and the fruit.
There's cookies and fruit, and there's coffee and all sorts of good stuff. So we want to visit with you. We want to have a good time hanging out with you. Now, today, we are going to have a really crazy, awesome time. It's going to get, like, crazy, crazy fun.
Does it get much crazier than bringing your guns to church? I mean, some of you guys can chill and carry, and that's okay, and that's all cool, but man, the rest of you, like, we invited you to bring your shotgun. One girl this morning, she told me, she said, "Where do I go with my chili?" And I'm like, "Right out to the white tent. They'll get you hooked up in the chili competition."
Where do I
and
go?
And she goes, "And what about my shotgun?" I'm like, "You know what?"
That's a girl.
I didn't know if I was supposed to bring it in. And I'm like, "You know, we'll just leave it in the car until after the service." Kind of can get scary if we all were packing in this room, right?
Girls,
we're going to have a blast.
Girls alone scare me. Girls with guns really scare me. Either way, because, I mean, you're just not going to mouth off to a woman with a gun. There's no telling what she's going to do. Go crazy on you. Okay, so I want to pray with you guys today because I believe that God wants to speak to your heart today. And I want us to just open our heart and our mind to what God would have to say to us, that we would receive it, that we would leave this place different than the way we came. Totally encouraged, totally inspired, that God wants to take us somewhere in our walk with Him. So if you would, let's join in prayer right now. Father, we are so grateful, God, for your presence in this place. God, I pray today, God, that you would open your word to us, that you would speak to our hearts, that you would show us and reveal the value of church, Father God, that we might be drawn closer to you, that we might become more like you, and that you would just align us with our purpose and our right positioning in you. We thank you, God, in advance for the great, great things that are to come today. God, keep us safe. Lord, today, and help us have a great time together as a family. In Jesus' name, everybody said,
amen,
amen, amen, amen. So, we all have habits in our lives, right? And we are all a result of the habits we have, right? You think about the habits you have, and you think about the person you are, and if you really just get honest with yourself, we're a product of those habits. So if we want to be great, if we want to accomplish or achieve great things, we've got to have great what?
Habits!
Right? Because we are only as good or only as great as the habits we have. So today, I want to talk a little bit about one of the highest habits, one of the most rewarding, one of the most beneficial habits we can have, and it has to do with the local church. Here's the problem with church, okay? We all have an idea of what church is, right? We all, you may have been raised in church your whole life. You may have never set foot in church until today, and we'll say, welcome home, right? But we all have, no matter where you're from, no matter what your background, no matter what your experience is, we all have an idea of what church is, okay? But what I want to do today is I want to help us to realize that just because you might think of church a certain way, maybe you've had a negative understanding of what church is, that doesn't mean that that's how church has to be. Because God wants church to be a certain way, and he's kind of made it clear to us that direction, that mission, that vision that he has for the local church. And we want to kind of debunk, we want to kind of unwrap some of those frustrations that many of us might have with church. And let's look at what the Bible says. Let's look at what God has to say about really the way he wants church to be. So what we did, this is really fun, we went out, we sent our next level life group. These are our college and career folks here at Mountain Rivers Church. They went out and they went into the streets and they started interviewing some people. Got a little crazy. I wish we had time to show the bloopers reel because there's some really good footage on that film. So, but let's go now out into the streets and let's see what next level found out.
Hey guys, it's Jake and Lisa here. We're so excited to be here Sunday morning. This week we had a little project going on.
The next level got together and we went around Grove interviewing people and figuring out what it is that they dislike about church. So check it out.
What do you dislike about church?
Oh. Honestly, having to wake up early in the morning. That's my pet peeve. Yeah.
What do you dislike about church?
Doesn't tell the truth.
What do you dislike about church?
I dislike the fact that it seems to be more about a show versus religion itself. It's more about showing face and showing that you're showing up within your community.
What do you dislike about church?
You gotta be really quiet.
What do you dislike about church?
Gossip.
Thank you.
What do you dislike about church?
Some churches are really ridicule people.
Critical?
Yeah.
Hypocritical kind of.
And like they'll go and do the things that they get onto you for. I've seen that a lot.
The reason why I don't like going to church is because most of them are very boring.
What don't you like about church?
Too confined.
Too confined? What do you mean by that? Explain.
Everybody's in a box.
They don't expand and try to reach every person, that's just their little group.
What do you dislike about church?
I dislike the religion about church. I'm more of a relationship with God type of guy. I don't like the ritualistic kind of, we have to sing a certain song, we have to read a certain part of the Bible, we have to do a certain thing to be, you know, acceptable. I'm all about being free and being open and having a closer relationship than just showing up and doing your thing.
Wow, what is it you dislike about church? Miss Campbell did an awesome job hitting the street. You know what I want to tell you this morning? That I think there are definitely some things that are happening in the church over the years that God himself would dislike. Yeah. For one, I can tell you right now, one thing that God would hate about church is if it was boring.
Oh!
The one girl said, I don't want to go to church because church is boring.
That's a sin.
Well, you know what? You've been going to the wrong churches.
It's a sin.
Because it's a sin to bore people in church. It's the 11th commandment. All right? No boredom here, all right? Somebody else said, I don't want to go to church because there's critics. Do you know that the Bible says that we are to love one another? Does it ever say criticize one another? No. God would dislike that too. God would dislike critics. He would dislike boredom. One girl said, I don't want to get up early. Well, you know what? That's why we have two services. Mount Movers, right? Sleep in, cruise on in at 11, get out at 12:15. You're home in time for your roast, right?
Roast. Who makes roast anymore?
I don't know.
Who makes roast? Raise your hand if you make roast.
Oh, yeah, look at
that. That's
your
roasting people in the house. That's awesome.
You're getting you dirty looks, man.
I know. I just got a bunch of dirty. How are you roasting?
Get all your roasting done. You know what? Church doesn't have to be the way that you thought about it being. Church doesn't have to be the way that you once experienced it. Because you know what? We all, as Brett said, have past experiences. You know what? I've been in churches that were boring. It was a sin. I mean, I was sat there and thought, this is a sin. What's going on is a sin right here. Because you're putting me to sleep, right? You know, we've been in those places, but you cannot just judge the entire church, okay? We're not talking about a building. We're talking about the establishment that Jesus Christ gave life for. You see, Jesus literally died for this thing called the church. Why would he literally lay down his life for a religious organization? He wouldn't. You know what he laid down his life for? A relationship. He laid down his life for the opportunity to be a friend to you and to me. And to literally have an ongoing relationship where you can talk to him, or where he can talk back, and where he can direct your life. And the local church plays a really big part in that. This morning, we want to help you in a non-boring way.
Yes, right? As non-boring as possible.
Non-boring. To rediscover what church really is all about according to the Word of God. This morning, we're going to give you four things. Now, you know what church is all about? Three things, or two things, or one thing, or four things, right? So today, we're just going to do four for you, all right? Here's what we're going to do. The first thing I want you to know is the local church, what Jesus gave his life for, helps you to know God. It helps you to know God. We don't just come to have a social club, although we like to party around here, right? We are getting ready to throw the biggest redneck party that this community has ever seen. I mean, if you drive down this road in about 1 hour, you're going to wet your pants.
Son, yes.
Because there's going to be so many shotguns going off right at the road.
Kind of at the road.
But we've already done it, and the BBs won't make it to the highway. But it will scare you if you're driving down the road, right?
Pull in. So I go, you're coming to church.
That's right. Pull on in. That's right.
Make me say pull. Make me say get the parking lot. That's how it works.
Yeah, we like to have fun, but listen, God wants you to know him. He wants the local church to be here to help you know him. How many of you guys are married in this room? Raise your hand. Don't be ashamed.
Somebody.
I know. Right? You're married.
Married.
Let me tell you something. If you are married, there's nobody in this world that knows your spouse like you do. Nobody. You've gone through things in life together. You've laughed, you've cried. There's things that only you as a couple will ever experience together. There's memories that nobody else is going to share. There's things like, I can just look at Brad,
right,
and I know what he's thinking.
Right.
And you're all thinking, that scares me. It scares me too. I mean, it does, right? Listen, the word know in the original language, when it was written, the word know literally meant to intimately know like a husband knows his wife. That is an intimate connection, all right? It's not knowing about, like, you know about Brad. I could ask tons of you, and some of you, if you're brand new, you've heard about our pastor, right? You've heard about Pastor Brad, probably.
Maybe.
Right? You heard these crazy stories, but I know him. I know him really well. I know what he's thinking. I can tell by the look on his face what's going on in that brain of his, right? That's the kind of relationship I can tell you right now.
You know what I'm thinking
right now. I do. I'm not going to say it. You're an idiot, right? That's what you want to say to me. Listen to me. God wants you.
That's right.
God wants you to know Him. And the local church helps you do that. If you've got your Bible this morning, we're going to look in John chapter 17 and verse 3. It's going to be right up there, and it says this. And this is the way to have eternal life. Pause. Did you know that this life is just temporary? This life we live here on earth in these temporary bodies,
right,
we're not going to live forever. How many of you guys know somebody who has ever died? Did you know that every 3 seconds, someone takes their last breath? Someone just passed.
That's real.
Every 3 seconds around the world, someone breathes their last breath. The Bible says that life is but a vapor. Do you know what a vapor is? It's like your breath. It's gone. Life here on this earth is just temporary. The things that we do, the careers that we have, the families that we raise, the money that we have, the possessions that you have, that awesome minivan I drive.
Yeah!
I mean, one day,
that's awesome.
I'm not going to get to take that minivan when my time comes.
Sad.
Have you ever seen a hearse with a U-Haul?
No.
It doesn't happen, right? Because you work your whole life for all of these things, and they're good things. We enjoy the pleasures of this life, the things that we work hard for. But listen, guys, it's all temporary. One day you'll breathe your last, and when you do, then there's eternity. The scripture tells us that the way to have eternal life, that is eternal life in heaven, is to know you. The only true God in Jesus Christ, the one you sent to earth. Jesus gave his life so that he could know you, so that his Father could know you, so that you could literally have a relationship with God. And the coolest thing is, you can be in a crowded room just like this, and there's lots of people that can feel all alone, surrounded by people. They feel all alone. But you know, the Bible says that God never leaves us, and he never forsakes us. He wants to be your best friend, and that's what the church is here to do, is to help you to know God.
That's good. So, have you ever had friends in your life, people that you connected with, and they just absolutely took you down the wrong path? Right? Relationships in our lives are so extremely powerful. We have to connect with the right kind of people, because just like our habits, relationships, the people we connect with are like habits, because we really become just like those people that we connect with. You know what I'm saying? How many times can you think back in your life, you think about these times when you connected with the wrong people and it got you into the wrong situations? You know what I'm saying? How many of you guys can attest to what I'm saying? Got you in the wrong situation. I remember when I was a little boy, about 4 years old, I'll never forget it. We lived in this neighborhood, and across the street there was houses on the other side of the street, and behind those houses was a big, huge, massive ditch. Like, this thing was the size of the Grand Canyon. It was huge. And my parents made it so clear to me that I was never, ever, ever, ever to go anywhere near that ditch. Especially after it had rained, because it was extremely, extremely dangerous. Now, I say this ditch was the size of the Grand Canyon. I went back and revisited this ditch about 3 years ago. That's about 5 foot deep. Because when you're a kid, everything is so much bigger, right? So I was in this canyon, right? How did I end up there? I was out in the street. My sister was with her gang, the bikers. Man, she was 10 and had the banana seat and the handlebars with little Frenchie deals hanging from the handlebars. And I wanted so desperately for you know, these older kids. They were like, I was 4 and they were like 10, all right? And I wanted them to like me. And I thought, I'll do anything if I can just be accepted by the gang. And they said, hey, Brad, why don't we go over the ditch? And I thought, I'm not supposed to go. Let's do this. And it just rained the night before. And I had my best friend, JJ. We were the same age. We were best buddies, man. Played every day together. He was awesome. And he was with us. And he knew he wasn't supposed to be in the ditch. And we went over there, and man, that thing was just covered in mud. I mean, it was bad. It was a soupy, muddy, nasty, horrible mess. It was like quicksand. It was awful. And he said, Brad, don't go go down there, go down there, go way up.
Okay, all right. Oh, yeah.
All right, so I make my way down to the ditch, and they say, hey, Bradley, why don't you throw a mud ball at JJ? I said, okay. I made some mud, and bam, I just nailed him, man. I nailed him, and he was like, no, you didn't. To me, and so he got some mud, he threw it at me, and then like just seconds later, it's like we were an all-out mud slinging match, right? And seriously, no joke, we were covered from head to toes in mud, right? We were brown people all over, nothing but mud. And the gang was up at the top of the cliff, the big gorge, and they were laughing. And I remember when we crawled out of the ditch, and some of the families, the big people, the adults, they were in the backyards, and they were like, oh, your mom's gonna kill you. So I start tiptoeing across the street, thinking, like, she can't see me if I'm tiptoeing, right? So I'm tiptoeing across the street, and my mom met me out in the yard, like, the chick was looking out the window. I don't know why she's standing out the window the whole time, like, she didn't have anything to do. So she's looking out the window, and she notices me coming across the street. She met me out in the grass of my front yard, whipped out the full name, Bradley Taylor Hilton.
I'm gonna die. I'm 4 years old. I've not even gone to school yet. I'm gonna die.
You're not gonna believe what she did to me. This is a true story. I don't lie. I'm a pastor. I don't make stuff up. She stripped me down practically naked.
Yep.
She grabbed the back of my fruit of balloons, which were white. And gave me the wedgie of a lifetime. So I'm like, I'm practically naked. She's holding my fruit of balloons, and she has a spray hose in her other hand. And she's spraying it up. Bradley Taylor, and I'm like, maniac for love. Actually, they hadn't written that song yet because it was like 79 or something. But so I'm totally drenched. Right, she's washing the mud off. All the neighbors are pointing at me and laughing. JJ was heading like to his house as fast as he could go because like a week earlier, I got a new plastic boat and we tried out the boat to see if it would float. And we filled up the sink while my dad was taking a nap and we forgot about it. And we totally like flooded the whole house. And he was downstairs and he came upstairs and he beat us both. And we were both like over the couch. And he was getting, I was getting, ever. So he like flew to his house, right? He's like, I'm not going in for seconds. This is not going to happen to me. Totally, completely humiliating. Humiliating. What's the moral of that story? I have no idea. No. I connected with the wrong people, right? I connected with the wrong. They got me in trouble. And if we have to connect with the right people in our lives because we become just like those people that we connect with. You know what I'm saying? So I remember later in my life, I was about 19 years old and gave my life to Christ. And I made a decision I was going to be in church every time the doors were open. And I got into this life group, like we have life groups on Wednesday nights. And I got in this life group, college and career, right? And I started making these friends. And, you know, they were all at different stages of their journey with Jesus. Some were just starting out. Some were way down the road in their journey. But we were doing it together. You know what I'm saying? And we connected like family. And we all were all about one. We were one in purpose, in our mission, in our mindset. We wanted to live for God, right? And so that is literally what began to change my life from the inside out. That's one of those incredible habits. I just said, I'm going to be in church every time the doors are open. I'm going to connect with other believers on a weekly basis. When I did that, I'm telling you, my life was never, ever, ever the same again. awesome. And that's what I want for everybody that I minister to, that I talk to. I want them to experience the same thing that I've experienced. So that's the second thing that we're talking about today. Church helps me connect with other believers.
Right. The third thing that the church helps you do is it helps you grow spiritually. How many of you guys know what babies do? Anybody knows what babies do? If you've ever had a baby in your home, if you babysit or maybe you've raised kids, when they get hungry, they do something, every one of them. Like, I don't know why God couldn't have created them to just like politely raise their hand and like just let you know politely and quietly that they're hungry. But that's not what they do. What do babies do? Ah! Ah! And you know what? Listen. You think your kids are cute, and they are, right? Your kids are beautiful.
Everybody thinks their kids are cute.
But nobody's kid is cute at 2 o'clock in the morning screaming for that bottle. And every mama in here knows what I'm talking about. And if you raise twins like me, you got double doses of kids screaming next to your bed, and you're just like, oh, I just want to get some sleep. But this baby is screaming. Why? Because they're hungry. Now, is that abnormal? No. Why? Because if you don't eat, you don't live. You want your kids to grow. You've got these babies and you want them to grow. It's normal for them to grow. You know, I had a friend years ago and she had a little girl. And that little girl was so cute. And at the age of 3, she just stopped growing. She just stopped. And they waited, you know, I mean, probably another year went by and they were like, this is so weird. I mean, she's like tiny. She was so tiny. Well, they started going to doctor, specialist, and after specialist. And they were trying to figure out why is this little girl not growing? Because it's not normal to stop growing. Listen to me. If you come to know God, if somebody introduces you to Jesus, or you come to the local church and you begin to learn about God, and learn about God wants me to have a relationship with Him, it's not normal to not grow. Because it's just like the physical body. God wants you to be nourished and He wants you to want to grow. I want you to look at the scripture in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2. It says this. Like newborn babies, you must crave spiritual milk. What is spiritual milk? Right here. It's God's word. This is what causes you to grow. We want you to crave it. So that you will grow into the full experience of salvation. Everything God has to offer you. Cry out for this nourishment now that you've tasted of the Lord's kindness. You see, when you come to church, we don't just introduce you to Jesus. We don't just help you connect with other believers, but we also want to help you to grow. If you stay this big spiritually, there's a problem. Because God intended you to grow. He intended you to experience all that He has for you. And you know what's amazing is if you go all the way back to the beginning, all the way back to where God created the world, and the Bible says that He literally walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the night or the morning. He would literally come down and go for a walk. I mean, God Himself, that's the kind of relationship He wants to have with you. And a lot of times, people give up. It's like, they kind of know in their mind that church is a good thing because I mean, it's the right thing to do. I'm trying to get my life together. I'm going to do the right thing. So I'm going to go to church, right? And we stop there. We kind of come to church and we listen to the message and hopefully we stay awake and we get a little something out of it and we go and we don't do anything else with it. But listen to me. God wants you to come in here. He wants you to not only hear the word of God, but He wants you to begin to apply it to your life. And as you do, it's just like taking in food every day. It's just like eating. You begin to grow and grow and grow. And I'll never forget one girl that came to church here 4 years ago this month. And she's now one of our leaders. And she would have been out there in the foyer when you came in. Her name is Shelby Maine. She came to church and their life was a pretty big wreck when they came here. We've shown their testimony before, but for her husband, they came to church and they just did exactly what Brad said. I'll never forget. Clayton and one of his buddies called Brad and said, they came to one service and then they said, can we take you out to dinner? Brad's like, food, I'm there, right? So they go out to dinner and they said, we want to know how to be like you. And I'm like, you have no idea what you're asking, right? Well, they didn't mean all the craziness, they meant spiritually. And Brad said, I want to tell you one thing. There's lots of things I can tell you. One thing, do this. Every time we unlock the doors of the church, be there. If you're there every time we unlock the doors of the church, your life will change. Guaranteed. That couple did exactly what Brad told them. That day, they made a commitment. Every time the doors are open, we're just going to be here. Does church change your life? No, but Jesus does. And the church helps you meet Jesus. And the church helps you grow spiritually. Shelby one time then, a few months later, came to us and she said, you know what's weird? It's like, I don't recognize myself anymore. I'm not the same person I used to be. You know what that tells me? She was growing. That part of why you come here is to grow spiritually.
The fourth thing is, you know, being in church helps to reveal the purpose that God has for you. Everything in our lives, if you really boil it all down, is really spiritual, okay? Before your marriage, before your family, before your finances, before anything else, your life is spiritual. Because at the very center of your core, God created you. And He created you with a purpose, all right? And this is really good. I want you to pay attention here. God created you with a purpose in mind to know Him, which she's talked about that, to know God intimately, to have a real and life-changing relationship with Him. I mean, we could preach on that for weeks. God wants relationship with you, all right? But then it's also to make God known, right? If your only purpose was just spiritually, was just to know God intimately in this life, the second you receive Christ as your Savior, you'd be raptured up and you'd go to heaven. If that was the only purpose for you being here, why would God just allow you to remain after you've given your heart and your life to Christ? I can tell you why. It's because God has a purpose more than just knowing Him, but also about making Him known. Now, a lot of us, it's so easy to get wrapped up in our career and building our family and building a home, and it's what kind of car I drive, it's my position, it's my status, it's my title, it's this, it's that, it's saving up my retirement. And we get wrapped up in this thing called life, and we are so inward focused, but that's not at all what God intended. All those things are fine. All those things are great, right? But it's not at the core, it's not really what we are all about. We are here because God wants us to know Him and to make Him known. So where does the church fit into all that? When you make God's house your priority, when you make it a habit to be in God's house, with God's people, in God's presence, then God begins to reveal to you really more of what that purpose is all about, right? Not just your relationship with Him begins to grow like crazy, but then you realize, hey, you know, God has given me gifts. He's given me abilities. He's given me talents. There's things that I love to do. And you know what? God wants you to use those things that you love to do and do it for Him. He wants you to use those things and figure out a way to do it in such a way that creates conversations, it creates exposure for others to know who God is through what you love. Isn't that crazy? It's like, think about this. There are things that you absolutely love to do. It could be fishing, it could be hunting, it could be painting, it could be riding a bike, it could be anything. What do you love to do? I believe with all my heart that God gave you a passion and a love for that thing because He wants you to use it as a tool, as a resource, to be able to create a channel by which you can make God known. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to stand up here on a stage, right? But God can use you. But I'm shy. I don't want to talk. I don't want to say anything. Hey, maybe God's calling you right. Right? In some way, shape, or form, God wants to use you mightily. Mightily. Each and every one of us. Right? You might be called to be a missionary in China. You might be called to serve on the serve team here in this church. Whatever it is, I'm telling you, God wants to reveal that purpose in your life. And here's really what it's all about. Until you figure out what that is, you're not going to be happy. True satisfaction in this life, contentment, right? Real peace in your life, in your heart, in your mind, I'm telling you, it doesn't come until you sync up with your purpose. Now listen, here's an example. Misty and I live in the middle of nowhere, right here in Four State area, in the middle of Nowhereville, USA. We do not have the resources that Donald Trump has, okay? We are not gazillionaires, okay? We don't live in a huge house. We do have a sweet minivan, I'll just say that. It is sweet. The paint is chipping off, okay? The plastic pieces inside of it have all fallen off, and you can see how things built. It's pretty cool. But can I tell you from the bottom of my heart, with everything inside of me, you couldn't take my happiness away. I am so extremely happy and blessed and satisfied and at peace and fulfilled because we're doing the dream. We're doing it. Man, we're loving God. We're loving people. We're using the gifts that He's given us to change lives. No amount of money on this planet could buy that. And man, I want that for you. I want you to come to a point in your journey with Christ where you're like, this is it. And I'm seriously, this is it. This is what I love to do. And I'm hooked up with people in church. I'm in God's house and I'm getting trained. And the Bible says in Ephesians 4 and 11, it says that our job as pastors, Christ, when He left, He gave the church gifts. And those gifts was leadership and that would equip the church, that's you and me, for the work of ministry. Now, don't let that word ministry throw you off, because when we think of ministry, we think, okay, I'm called into the ministry. That's not what it means. Ministry means your purpose. So, break it down now. Anybody got a bebop? Break it down. We are called as pastors to... We got a blooper of Mason bebopping.
We should have used it right there.
I mean, what? If we can pull it off for churches out, that'd be awesome. So, that dude's a bebopping sucker. So we're going to break it down, right? I didn't remember what I was saying. It was really good, too. Right? God wants to help you to realize what that purpose is.
Right.
And He wants to use church to get you there. Does that make sense? So let's kind of review these real quick. Church helps us to know God intimately, to build that relationship with God. Church helps us to connect with other believers in the faith. Right? Church helps us to grow spiritually. And the church helps to reveal our purpose. I want so bad for you to get to that point where you get it. And I'm telling you, you will never be the same again. Just like the great and awesome Shelby Maine, she said, I don't even recognize myself. It's crazy. So fulfilling. We look back now, 9 years of real and contagious life change. And we see all these people who have come through these doors, who God has gotten a hold of them, and man, it's awesome. It is awesome. It is so fulfilling as pastors to look at these lives and see how God has gotten hold of people and changed them from the inside out. He's restored families. He's restored finances. He has mended relationships. It is amazing when you just let God be God in your life, right? When you just give up, quit trying to be God, and just let God be God, right? It's a lot easier than it sounds. You can do it, right? So what we want to do is we want to play a video right now.
Before we do, I want to tell you, we're going to show you a really cool video as we celebrate 9 years. But in 2001, God told us, Grove, Oklahoma, and you're going to see on this video how we come to know God said, here, in this city, this is where we were coming. And it did come up to come up.
Some of those old Chinese Viking films.
Yeah, to come to find out.
What?
Come to find out. God was going to plant us outside of Grove, but what I want you to know is this, and you guys see a lot of our team is wearing these shirts, and they say this, Mount Rivers Church, a church, this is defining us, a church that
You picked out the graphic.
Hold on, I did.
For people who don't like
church. That's right. A church for people who don't like church. And listen to me, you may be shy, right? You may say, I really can't talk to people. Listen. Get one of these shirts for $5. We're not making a penny. We're losing money. It's not a good business deal. It's a marketing ploy for the gospel of Jesus, all right? This shirt is like, a lot of people go,
I don't get it.
We're supposed to like church. Listen to me. I had a seventh grader. She's this tall. We pulled these shirts out on Wednesday night, and she said, I get it. We want to go find people who don't think they would like church to come to Mount Rivers Church because they will love our church. Listen to me. When God told us to plant a church in Grove in 2001, He told us to not plant a church like everybody else had planted a church. This area didn't need one more church that was normal. God needed something different. We came to this city, to this spot, to reach people who thought they never would ever want to go to church. People who thought, church isn't for me, the walls would cave in, I want nothing to do with church. 9 years ago this month, we started with one couple on our living room couch. I want you to watch this video and see what God did.
So one night, on our way home, we had been in Tulsa for a speaking engagement for the college, and I was actually driving and we were headed back on I-44, headed home to Joplin. That's where we lived and went to school. And it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, and this was in 2001, like in the fall of 2001. And we're driving, and of course, we both fall asleep behind the wheel, so we're both extremely tired. And, you know, for me, I just want to get home. And we are coming down I-44 and we start seeing these signs, and it says Grove Afton exit. And we saw one and then we saw the next one, and Brett said, pull off, take this exit. And I said, have you lost your mind? It's 2 o'clock in the morning. He said, pull off, take this exit. And I, so this is the actual spot, and this is the sign that we saw that night at 2 o'clock in the morning. And as you can see, it says Afton Fairlane Grove exit. It was on this highway that night that Brad said, pull off right here. And so I pull off reluctantly and we take the exit and we come into Grove. We get to the toll booth and Brad said, when we saw that sign, Grove Afton, God said it's Grove. And I said, it's Grove? Like it's Grove? Like we're planting our church in Grove? I said, are you positive? He said, God just spoke to me. So we spent the next couple hours driving around the town of Grove, which Brad had never been to, but believe it or not, my family only lived about 20 minutes from Grove. My grandma at that time actually lived in Grove on the lake. So Grove was not unfamiliar to me. I was completely blown away at that moment that God would be calling us to plant a church so close to my family, who I was very close to. So that night, we drove all over Grove. We looked at the lake. We looked at the biggest churches. We looked at everything Grove had to offer, and headed home that night in the fall of 2001, not knowing when, but knowing where God had told us to now plant our church. So this is actually where it all started, right here. Believe it or not, this spot that we're standing is where we ended up in a mobile home, and Mountain Movers Church really got started. So, this was the house. This is the farmhouse where God had opened the door.
It was our next step from the mobile home.
So, a little apprehensive and not super excited, we decided that maybe this is where God would want us, even though this is not what we wanted. And so we started looking for an opportunity to remodel it, because as you can see, this place needed a lot of work. It's amazing what a little bit of paint and some new carpet and, you know, just a little bit of repairs, what it could do to a place. And so it took maybe about a month. And then we started having services in this building.
Yeah.
Now,
which gave us so much more room to grow from having a little circle in the living room and, you know, with the piano, to being able to really expand the Bible study to become more like a service.
Yeah. And so when we moved in here, it was actually September, the first Sunday in September of 2007. The place was remodeled. And we had our very first service. It wasn't about building.
That's what I was going to say. It's not about building a building, but it's about building people, because the church isn't a building at all.
It's the people.
The church is the people. And you know, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And so when God dwells inside of us, we're His church.
But what was really interesting is that when you don't have a building,
right,
it's really hard in America when you don't have a building,
right,
to get people to come.
Right.
And so God was always one step ahead of us. But, you know, the mission of this church has and always will be that we would lead people into a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus that's contagious.
Right.
That's why we exist. And so through every single process that takes place, from the mobile home with one couple on our couch to starting Promised Land, the daycare and the day camp, to moving into a farmhouse and then renting a gym and then breaking ground and building a building. All of those were about building people.
About people.
And every phase, God sent more and more people. And we would pray and still to this day pray, God send people from the north, the south, the east, and the west, that we could lead them into that real and life-changing relationship with you that's contagious.
Right.
Because that's what we're here for. I mean, we have a relationship with Christ personally, and it's that driving force that causes us every day to get up and say, okay, God, who can we win today? Who can we share your love right. with? And not, it's not about religion. It's not about rituals. It's about a relationship.
Right.
Just take some time to thank God for what he's done. And you know, what's amazing to me is, if you haven't noticed, we're out here in the middle of nowhere, all right? And you know, you'd say to yourself, why on earth would God plant a church like this in the middle of nowhere? Because when you look at the textbooks, right, when it comes to starting a church, that's not in there. Usually go where people are, and usually go, you know, into a city where there's a lot of people, and usually take a big team of people with you, and usually take a big budget with you to help you get it started. We didn't do any of that. And you say, why, God? You know, I've been asking God why for years. But honestly, this is why. Look around at what God can do with nothing. He has to get the glory. He has to get the honor. It has nothing to do with missing out. It has everything to do with the fact that God wanted to do something beyond the natural. He wanted to do something miraculous, something supernatural in a desert place in the middle of nowhere where there was nothing. And he said, I'm going to birth a life-giving force that's going to change lives for eternity in the middle of nowhere. And he has to get the glory. He has to.
I want to tell you this morning that when you rediscover church, what you discover is you don't have to go to church. You get to go to church. We look forward to coming and unlocking these doors, not because we get to stand up here, because I'd just as soon be back there. But it's a privilege to get to come and rub shoulders with incredible people. And you know, you look back over 9 years, some of you, your faces were in those pictures. And it's hard to believe that you've been around with us for that long. Some of you, today's your first day. And I hope that we see your face back here as we continue down the road, because this is just the beginning of what God's doing here in this local church.
That's right. Would you stand up with us today? If you guys would like for you to bow your heads with me. You know, I'll just be very, very honest with you. Today, You know, we do these events like this. We call it an outreach because it allows us to reach out and to attract people that would not normally want to go to quote-unquote church. And you might be one of those people here today. And I want to tell you that we wanted to create this opportunity for you because we wanted to change the way you think about church. Just because you've seen church done a certain way doesn't mean that that's the way it was meant to be. And we want to show you that church can be different. Church can be fun. Church isn't full of critical people. Right? Church is not all of those things that we saw in that video. Church is what we make it. Church is the people. And if you're in this place today, and you know church is not a weekly part of your life, my challenge to you is if you will just start one habit, one life-changing habit of just being in church every time the doors are open, I'm telling you, you will not recognize yourself. Everything else will follow, all right? There's so many other things I could mention that you need to do, but those things will come when you take that first step. The rest will fall into place. So what I want to do right now, nobody's looking around. I'm not going to call you up. I just want to know. If you're in this place today and you say, Pastor, I hear everything that you've said today. You have revealed the value of church to me. I get it. I understand. And you'd say, Pastor, I'm going to make the commitment today that I am going to be in church as often as I can, as often as it's available, and I'm able to make it happen. I'm going to do everything within my power. I'm going to be in God's house with God's people because I want what you're talking about. I want to see my purpose revealed. I want to be happy. I want to be content in Christ. I want everything you guys were talking about today. If that's you, just be honest with me, be honest with yourself, be honest with God. Just say, I need more church in my life. Would you raise your hand today? Mm-hmm. Anybody else today? Say, I need to make this habit in my life. Amen. 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 I want to pray for you right now. Father, God, I'm so grateful for the gift that you've given us, Father God. Thankful for the church. You died for the church because you loved her so much. You loved us so much. Your word says that broad is the way that leads to destruction and narrow is the way that leads to everlasting life. I know, God, that you've given us this gift, the church, Father God, to help us along the way to make it through that narrow gate that leads to eternal life. I pray, God, today for those who have not made this a high habit in their life, God, high priority. I pray, God, that you would give them the strength, give them the consistency and the discipline to walk it out, and I pray that their life would never be the same.
Your head's bowed and your eyes so closed. I just want to take a moment to just ask you, do you know God? Do you know God the way I was talking about knowing him? Do you have a personal, intimate relationship with him? Life is truly just a vapor. It's here and then it's gone. And if today were your last day in this temporary life, do you know confidently that you would enter into the next life, into eternity? Do you know where you would spend it? Would you spend it with Jesus forever? Do you know that confidently? If you don't, this morning I want you to know it's so simple. It wasn't simple. It wasn't a simple process. Jesus had to give his life. But for you, the Bible makes it so easy. It so clearly says that each of us are sinners saved by grace, that we have all fallen short of God's glory. So all you have to do is admit, I'm a sinner. I'm a person who is not living up to God's standard. I admit that. Believe that Jesus Christ is who he says he is, that he really did come from heaven to earth, that he gave his life, that he was resurrected and went back to stand at the right hand of the Father. And confess with your mouth that he is Lord of your life. When you do that, you enter into this new relationship. It's like saying, yes, I want to be your friend. Yes, I want to know you. Yes, I want to start this journey with Jesus. What you do, it's the greatest
decision you'll ever make in your life. This morning, with every head bowed, every eye closed, I want to just give you that opportunity. If that's you, if you want to have that kind of relationship, that kind of confidence in your eternity, I'm going to count to three, and when I do, I want you to just raise your hand. No one's looking around but your pastors. We want to pray for you. Then together we're going to pray as a church and let you invite Jesus into your heart. On the count of three, if that's you, you want a real relationship with Jesus, raise your hand. One, two, three. Amen. I see your hand. Amen. Amen. I see hands. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I see your hand. Amen. Best decision, amen. The best decision I ever made was when I dropped my pride and I surrendered to Christ. I experienced true happiness. Life wasn't necessarily always easy, but it was possible with faith in Jesus Christ. We're going to pray together. Just repeat after me. Father God.
Father God.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
I'm in need of a Savior.
I'm in need of a Savior.
I ask that you would come into my heart.
I ask that you would come into my heart.
Forgive me of my sins.
Forgive me of my sins.
I want a real relationship with you.
I want a real relationship with you.
In Jesus' name I pray.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Amen. Would you just give a big round of applause for all of us?
Thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mountain Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.